Well, baby, let's VFX and chill. Our weekly talk show where Seth and Hashi break down visual effects from movies and shows. Then try to put them back together again. Oh baby, let's VFX and chill. Our weekly talk show where Seth and Hashi break down visual effects from movies and shows. Then try to put them back together again. Oh baby, let's VFX and chill. Weekly talk show where Seth and Hashi break down visual effects from movies and shows. Then try to put them.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very exciting edition of VFX and Chill. Today, as you can tell from our intro, we are covering Mission Impossible. Jurassic Park. I thought we were doing Mission Impossible. We made the whole intro and stuff.
I thought we were putting Raptors into. Oh, no. Yeah, we can do whatever you want. Whatever you want, Hash.
That's true. Whatever we want. And by we, I mean myself, Hashi, right here, as you can see below. And also right over here is my lovely co-host, Seth.
So lovely. Both of us are so lovely. And as always, we have with us Michael Salapsky. Oh, right. Michael's not here today. We'll just go home. Bye, everybody. Miss you.
Wait. Michael's not here. I think that means that we could do whatever we want, right?
Whatever we want. Literally whatever we want. Okay.
Yes.
So let's talk about some things. I want to talk about.
Yeah. So have you heard of this series called Mission Impossible?
I have heard of this series called Mission Impossible. I'm a big fan of this series.
Impossible colon another title.
That's what it's called. 100%. Let's see. So I've got here. Let me see if I go to the clips. Can we see some clips playing? We can.
Oh, wait a second. This is that series. It's crazy guys always
impossible.
Trying to do the impossible.
Yep, exactly. So here's the deal. I love Mission Impossible movies. I've seen them all. A lot of people right now are doing rewatches because this new one coming up, and I don't understand why you would need to do a rewatch.
What they've been doing with their Saturdays for the last 7 years.
Yeah. Does no one else watch these movies every 3 to 4 months? Like, it doesn't make sense to me that you need to recap what goes on in these movies. But nonetheless, I'm very excited. There is a shocking, moving number of shots like this where Tom Cruise is just looking mad. Like, let's see. Let's count them. We got one here where he's like, "No, you didn't say that to me. You didn't just give me a mission that is not possible."
Wait, and is this an Ethan Hunt thing or is this a Tom Cruise thing?
Oh, because they're one and the same now. Everyone Tom Cruise plays is now Tom Cruise. Like this is Maverick, is Ethan Hunt, is Tom Cruise, is the guy from Magnolia. So I think you were the one who suggested, like, why don't we,
first of all, when this trailer came out, I was, a little bit obsessed with the opening shot to it. Which let's see, I could share my screen.
This one right here.
Just to mention, it's that one right there. I was like, wow, that is daring and bold. And that's it's very dangerous. I would have stopped the motorcycle earlier and maybe crawled on my belly over to the cliff if I needed to assess something.
Can I say what I think spoke to you about this is that there is an inertia, like a momentum happening in this that gets stopped right there.
The Akira slide momentum, if you will.
And I think, having known you for a while now, Hash, I think that when there's some kind of movement happening in a frame and it's stopped, you just want it to keep going. You see an opportunity to change things for the better. Want me to go to your screen?
Let it cache a little bit for a second, okay. and then we'll load it up.
So the idea here was like, well, I'll just say it from my perspective.
All right, now we're good.
All right. So from my perspective, Slack, you said, well, you want to just raptorize the Mission Impossible trailer this week? I was like, yeah, why not? And I started going through it and I'm watching it and I was like, oh man, right at the top, you could just have him like, not even just the motorcycle shot. You can have like the big one everyone talks about. That first one, you could just have him kind of slide right off and fall off. And then I saw in Dropbox, bikefall.aep. And I was like, he's already on it. And so we started talking. Yeah. So that's where I'll move to you to show what you've been doing this week.
So that led to, I couldn't resist doing this.
You brought that further along since I last saw it.
All right. So it's a phenomenal original shot. Like it's a really cool, it's very dynamic. It comes to this perfect stop right at the edge there. And even his body kind of pops up right there for a second for the lean to look over, which I'm like, wow, that is, there's so much momentum right there in that moment before getting to this nice reveal. And so what I figured I would do is have him do what I just sort of previewed here.
Can I show real quick the version you had rendered last night?
Oh, please.
So this is the clip last night that Hashi had done. Just literally, like, he got it here and then just rendered it because we both had to sign off. But we were throwing up from laughing at... Like, I almost didn't want you to change it.
Pretty great.
So
I did make it a slightly more dignified fall after a while. But, that's a shot that will break down a little bit during the course of the show.
To answer some questions. So we didn't really designate who's going to answer people's questions in the chat, but I do want to say, Andrew Smith, you're asking, will anyone read my questions without Michael here? Why would you even ask that? We don't have Michael. So yes, we will be reading your questions from the chat. Hashi and I both randomly will read them out and answer them or make fun of them as we usually do. We can't promise they'll be as factually reliable as they normally are, but they will be funny. Now, facts and funny.
Seth, break down our concept for what we want to do today overall.
Overall, okay. So the idea here is... we want to, I'm going to turn my guides back on. We want to go through the mission. I've cut a shorter version, an abridged version of the Mission Impossible trailer, Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning. As I've done before with our Raptor videos, we were like, you know, it'd be funny if he was just like he fell off the cliff and the next time we saw him do the cliff jump, he had like a neck brace and like casts on. And then we both realized what if we just made Tom Cruise increasingly more injured throughout the trailer? So is it, or Ethan Hunt really, if we made Ethan Hunt look increasingly more injured with body casts and neck braces and butterfly band-aids, black eyes, just made him look like he was getting like real world repercussions from all of the things that are happening and,
just in Nicolas Cage at the end of Snake Eyes, if I him.
Yes. Oh man, great. And it's Brian De Palma, so it's right, you know, in the wheelhouse.
It really is. We're like bringing it full circle.
And if you look at it, this shot wants him to be in a sling. Like, look at how he's punching this guy with his arm.
Like that was the direction he got from the stunt coordinator. It was like, no. Like less like a boxer and more like your arm is caught in a sling.
Yeah, more like Seth and Hashi are going to make you injured in this. And so. We've got some very fun plans for this. Like here, for example, I just want his head to hit the tunnel as he goes down. And again, we're not killing him, and we're not even going to be super brutal like with gore or anything. We just think it's funny if he's just increasingly physically injured. This shot right here is one I'm very excited about, where he says, What's the line he says here? Let's see.
The line is,
your life will always matter more to me than my own.
Your life will always matter more to me than my own. And the idea is that he'll be in a full face cast, like with some blood seeping underneath right here.
Oh my goodness. So yeah, we clearly have a big variety of types of shots that we want to do, which means that we'll be covering a lot of like random little tips. To sort of summarize, one of the first things I'm going to show off is an interesting experiment we did with deep faking on top of Cinema 4D models as a way to get, bespoke Tom Cruise shots into this trailer. We're also going to, I can mention how I used some camera projection for that motorcycle falling off the cliff shot. So kind of just some blending between real and CG kind of stuff. We also, this morning I was creating some versions of Tom Cruise's face bandaged up using the cloth dynamics in Cinema 4D, and it was a ton of fun. So I think it would be something that would be fun for you to do anyway. And then also, oh, where is the shot with the IV, Seth? That is one of my...
Oh, yeah, 100%.
I love that you mentioned this.
I just thought this shot right here, if he was rolling like the IV, like pole with the IV bag hanging on it.
Just like holding.
And holding I have it. To imagine the ground is not smooth there, that it's like that rocky, like this like bricky kind of like ground. So it would just be like shaking everywhere as he's pushing it. And you found an IV bag. I'm going to go to you here. You found this and you've already got it shaking.
So here we go. So I'll show everyone how to set up this. It was a little IV bag. I don't entirely know where the arm will be, but I decided to grab this to hook up the IV to a stand-in arm. And the fun thing about this, about using physics like this, is that you really can, you know, just grab any of these things and like, oh no, I've made chaos. But yeah, like these are all the physics systems working together. Some, you know, like some rope and some. Dangly bits and whatnot. So dangly bits coming up later on the show today.
But for now,
so yeah, all sorts of things: cloth physics, ropes physics, dangly bits,
ropes physics. For now, though, I really want to talk about the thing you posted this week in your research for this week's episode and the stupid video we're about to make. You went down a rabbit hole, Hosh, as you usually do, and boy, did you end up places.
I did, and we're gonna have the cheap tricks version of Hashi explain all of this. It's actually a different person than me,
which
most people don't know.
So,
but like we sound a little bit alike, but there's just an energy that guy brings, you know.
So take it away, cheap Hashi or trick Hashi.
Wait a second, is that an editable Tom Cruise right in Cinema 4D? Not exactly. We wanted to put Ethan Hunt in our next video, and I really like this still image of him and all the intensity, but it's very low res, and so I sent it to Topaz Photo to get a higher resolution version of it. I took just this face layer, then inverted the selection, and then I used the Adobe Photoshop Beta's Generative Fill. And it gave me several totally plausible versions where his neck is visible, too. Hey now. I fed this to the Avatar SDK demo, which allows you to take a single photograph and turn it into a 3D head. It's not the most perfect 3D head, and the material is actually really small, but I'm going to go ahead and deal with that over in Cinema 4D. Once in Cinema, I used the mesh brush tools to kind of warp and scale around this Tom Cruise head, just so it would have some proportions and silhouette a little bit more close to... Oh dear God. Maybe if I'm lucky, I can use a different photo-scanned hairstyle, and so I wouldn't exactly call it a dead reckoning. I mean, a dead ringer for Tom here. And in fact, I even went a few steps further, adding some pose morphs, so I have one dial that can make him even madder. And also this little neutralizer dial, which kind of turns him into Scott Bakula. And I don't mind that this doesn't look exactly like Tom Cruise, because I'm going to be running it through a secondary process of the program Deep Face Live, which basically does just what you would imagine, which is to take this Tom Cruise and apply a deepfake to it in nearly real time. I can even use some of these deformers to make Tom Cruise a little bit madder, or give him a slightly more neutral face. I can use any of these sculpting brushes and basically transform little bits of Tom Cruise. And even if they look silly here, they're going to translate to a real expression that that deep fake has been trained on. So I could make him a little bit more smiley. Look at that nice smile. And amazingly, even right here in the viewport, if I decided to add some lights, the deepfake is going to try to match the lighting too. Isn't that crazy? The possibilities are endless as long as I'm working specifically with this Tom Cruise model that was pre-trained. Now, what exactly are Seth Worley and I doing with a virtual Tom Cruise? You'll have to tune into this week's episode of VFX and Chill to find out.
Which you did do. Now,
which you did. Welcome.
Hashi, I'm going to go to your screen right now because the people need to see what's happening over here. That's incredible. Okay.
Hey, everybody.
Well, that's enough. Let's not say anything of that ever again.
Never.
So, no. Let's talk. You want to talk through that more?
Sure. So, what I am running here is a program called DeepFace Live. It is a little bit intense on a computer, but obviously what it does is it takes one feed and puts it through a deepfake pass. So one of the things that we've noticed the more deepfakes have been out there in the world is that it's really important to have similar physical characteristics or expressions to the person that you are deepfaking. There are some very good performers who can do a very good Tom Cruise that contribute to a phenomenal looking deepfaked Tom Cruise social media account, which exists. My goodness, I am forgetting his name right off the top of my head. But
it's Tom Cruise.
Yeah, Tom Cruise. So anyway, like you can see the difference between my general proportions and Tom Cruise's. Also, I make different types of expressions. But if I try to mimic Tom Cruise expressions, he can be pushed into standard expressions that he really makes, like the laugh. The That's my favorite, honestly. I figured that this might be an interesting thing to mix with some CG stuff. So if you'll bear with me for a second, I think that I can set up, this is a program called Split Cam, which allows you to take your webcam or any other input and sort of mix them together. So this is going to look a little bit weird for a moment because I'm going to capture my screen with it. And then I'm going to feed my screen through to DeepFace Live. And then I'm going to open up Cinema 4D, try to sandwich it on one side, and then where'd I go? DeepFace Live. Where's the output? Where's the output window for it? Here we are.
It's like Mark Cuban Cruise. Mark Cruise.
It is. Mark Cruise. Okay, let's close the.
For the reasons I'm out.
Excellent. Okay, so now I think we're getting to the fun stuff. Okay, so here we have this Tom Cruise model on one side. And then on the other side, you have Tom Cruise being put through the deep fakery thing, which is just so silly to me that something like this kind of works. And I think as I demonstrated in that thing, I added a couple of little expressions and sliders in here so you can make him a little bit more upset. And you can see the clear difference between how cartoonish, like I just knew that it needed to be a blend shape that tried to push Tom Cruise's, you know, face into a general expression of disgust as I turn it up or down. But basically anywhere in between, the deepfake is going to interpolate, which is pretty cool. Same thing for, I think, where's my neutral face, which looks ridiculous
here. Super neutral.
Here.
Yeah.
Super neutral. But right here, like, you never see Tom Cruise this zoned out. He's always focused, and so there's something about this that's really disconcerting to me about seeing him like this. But the advantage of the weird amount of control that you have over something like this, and I'm surprised it's working so smoothly while streaming. I'm pretty pleased about that. But let's see. Let's go to Tom Cruise's face, and we'll go to our mesh brushes right here. I usually have them docked, but I realize I haven't updated my layouts properly, and so I'm missing new buttons in my old layout. But the grab tool is a really great one because it just quickly reshapes a little something or other. So if I wanted to, I'll size this down, and we'll do like a little smile. And that, look, it added a little crease right there. In,
still
in his face.
Unsettling, though, on the Tom Cruise side.
Oh, yeah. So clearly, the closer these proportions actually are to Tom Cruise's, the more realistic this Tom will look. And there is a certain angle at which it'll fall apart, which is around here. So this is really only good for a specific range of Tom Cruise. But I had a feeling that if we needed a digital double and we wanted to be able to kind of sometimes have him upset, sometimes have him, like, here's more of his focused expression, and then sometimes he would get a little bit more intense as he was doing some, like, action scenes or fighting scenes.
Absolutely.
That we could recreate those. So, obviously, I'm just expanding in longer format what I just showed you in that little edited video.
It's because it's freaking cool.
Because it's cool. It's weird. It's weird, right?
No, I don't. I mean, it's not what's weird about it.
Let's see. How...
Frigby, chill weather, you won. He said, would you call this cruise control?
That's pretty good.
That's for you, Frigby. You did it. You won the coveted content drop this week.
Insanity. So, we have this tool at our disposal, but we also really want to preserve the filmmaker's original intent. Which is, you know, like utilizing as many of the, you know, like of the amazing shots that exist already within the trailer to modify and monkey with them. So, Seth, where are you thinking about starting? I'm going to close down this deep face live stuff.
Go for it. Let's close down that deep face. So I'm leaning toward, so I'm just going to start with, I think I kind of structured this in a way, I tried to structure this in a way to where the injuries will, we'll stay reverent to like the implied timeline of the movie. Like certain scenes, mm-hmm. It seem like they're near each other. Like we don't want to have his injuries jump up a whole lot, but I also definitely wanted it to be an increase in stuff on him and injuries over the course of it. Along with scattering throughout it, you know, reasons for it, like fights and falling off a cliff and,
absolutely,
various stuff. So what I'm thinking is this, like, there's, you've got this falling off a cliff shot, which is looking pretty great already. And then we got this reveal where I'm thinking just a simple neck brace on him would be really fun. Would read well, in silhouette.
Oh yeah.
And then here we were talking, you and I were talking about whether he has the neck brace or not, having green screening in the left arm and having it, you know, be wrapped in gauze. Like that's what he's been doing, is wrapping it in gauze. And then, or is he wrapping the other one in gauze? I don't remember what our idea was.
Like that arm looks like it's the one that's like unspooling.
Okay.
Tape. I don't know. We could experiment with what's
you're right. He's like
film.
Ripping it from his mouth or something. I know it's slow, but like, and he's reaching down for some tape or something. Then here,
what,
I've already
what
start
might work is just like one arm is sort of held up. Like his left arm is sort of held out still. Like we erase the envelope and gun.
Yeah.
Like just, so it's just like a table and then his arm is going straight out and all he's doing is he has the thing of tape and he's unspooling a teeny bit of tape and it's implied that he's, you know, dressing these wounds.
Definitely. Just a reminder that your feed is still coming through for your face as your screen.
Oh yeah.
So then, I've actually already started on this shot, this smoke look shot, which, let me see if I have it pulled up, isn't looking like perfect, but it's still pretty funny. So I've just put the neck brace on. I haven't done any of the face, the like black, I want to give him a black eye, I think, and a scar of some kind, or not a scar, but like a butterfly band-aid of some kind. And this was tricky. This freaking, like, there's
that. I mean, what's, yeah, go ahead and talk about,
no,
the
you go ahead. So tell me compliments.
Well, it looks phenomenal because like right when you cut to it, I know exactly what that is. That's a, there's a person with his, with a, one of those funny foam neck braces around them. And it looks great. And if my compositor brain were to turn on for a second, it makes me realize, well, wait, when you have something snugly fit to a character like that, or any kind of CG costume enhancement, you have this tricky business of overlapping elements.
Risky business, one could say.
It's a very risky business.
Michael's not here, so we can't. I have to do it.
You have to. It's fair. But yeah, Tom Cruise, his neck's got to be through that thing. But then his head has got to be sitting on top of that same thing. And so you end up with a weird situation where as he's turning his head and moving around, I would imagine this is kind of annoying to deal with.
It is. And that's why it still doesn't even look super good if you watch it like closely. So we've got the plate, which looks like this. And then I've got an element on it, which is frightening. It is. Let me turn off ambient occlusion. So I made this guy. I made this brace just out of a simple tube in Cinema 4D.
Genius.
Which using the shear distortion, whatever this is called, the shear deformer. And I had it up against this like this default head that we use in a lot of stuff for placeholders. And sent that over to Element, and I put some material that I had, some fabric material onto it. And then I have the head still in there as, but I have it set to our old friend, Matt Shadow, which makes him invisible.
Oh, Matt Shadow. How's he doing?
I love Matthew Shadow. And it allows him to, well, I haven't seen him in a while, Matt Shadow, and I really don't know if I will ever again. But he leaves, the whole world is in his shadow when, I can't do this. The point is, I have him set to Matt Shadow so that he'll, I was hoping that this default head would do all the roto work for me. It did not.
That happens.
So, but what it does do is it provides some ambient occlusion down here where I really want it underneath the chin and stuff like that. Then, on top of that, I've got this really, I used Mocha to just isolate his chin down here, and it's really chattery. It's not great. And then I have Roto. This is what Roto Brush immediately wanted to do. It did not want to Roto around his chin. It didn't recognize his chin. It didn't. So I just took what I could get from Rotobrush.
That's a difficult scenario. Yeah, I mean, you're right. Like, it's a visual distinction that we make, but in terms of segmentation, it's a weird one for a computer to understand.
Exactly. And then I sent, especially for it to understand, like, what we're actually doing here.
Why?
So I sent the Rotobrush into Mocha and put this mask around it. Or this mat around to like basically serve, give me the roto of the top of his head and merged it with my roto of his chin. And for some reason this was, and why didn't I just do roto brush all around or not roto, but Mocha all around him? Cause I didn't want to do all around his ears and handle all of that tracking. I just wanted to do one simple track
contact point right there.
And then, so that's the layer that I have there on top of those things. And then, this is what it looks like without Supercomp. And, with Supercomp, I did the automatic color correction. Let me just turn these off so you can see the effects I've got. This is what the color correction turned on. I just clicked match background and it matched the black and white levels. And then I added a layer of haze onto it and turned it up because this is a big smoky room that he's in. And lastly, this was your suggestion, was on top of the roto face stuff. I put CC light sweep set to a gray color, which was color picked from somewhere in here.
Intuitive.
Set to composite, and that adds a little bit of that shadow on the edge of his face. And now we've got this this shot of him with the brace. So now I think next I'm going to try this shadow run shot and see if I can put the neck brace on him here.
Shadow run. Mission Impossible. Shadow run.
Part 1.
We've got to make a list of how many Mission Impossible additional titles we could come up with during this.
The one I'm most excited about is Mission Impossible River Love.
River Love.
Yeah.
Mission Impossible.
Probably going to be the most exciting one.
Like, that's the one you take, like, like you take your mom to see, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So anyway, Mission Impossible Arm Gauze. That's another one.
Arm Gauze.
It's going to be
tape dispenser.
So, all right, let's not get ahead of ourselves with River Love. Hashi, what are you doing over there?
Let me break down a little bit of what, I did for this cliff shot, because there's a lot going on and it's still not complete or anything like that. But, there is a lot going on. So one of the first things that, I have the benefit of having done this in a lot of incorrect steps to get to the point that I ended up in. Because when I'm looking at the shot, it's actually a very simple shot in terms of the number of elements in it. It's you know, Tom Cruise on a motorcycle. There is a foreground cliff kind of thing, and then there's a background cool vista that they look at. And I guess technically so Tom Cruise when you pick him up again on this other side. So this is all before any color timing, super comp kind of stuff, but it's all prepped for it. So one of the very first things that needed to happen was I needed to, let's go all the way back to the original footage. So in the original footage, you've got Tom Cruise coming up to the cliff here. So obviously for the rest of the shot, or much of the rest of the shot, you have Tom Cruise visible here as the vista gets revealed. And so it means that you need something to paint in all of that area. Now, obviously, the easy way to do that these days is to use content-aware fill right inside of After Effects. And so I did a version of that, which is basically I slowly matted out more and more little pieces like this. I cut off the bottom letterboxing because I didn't want that to interfere with anything. And I used an AI-based roto thing from Blaze Plugins here. And so that got out a lot of Tom Cruise there. And then when I did content-aware fill on that business, I got this back, which was okay. There's a couple weird little pops and business. But overall, because it's a slowly tilting moving shot, like that's the best kind of scenario for content-aware fill, is just to look at these motion vectors and try to fill in whatever wasn't there. However, there was this weird little moment at the beginning, right, where the head is sort of obscuring this part the whole time, and it was a little funky looking. And so I slowly would basically just block out sections with this little silhouetted solid that I had it re-render any of the holes that were left in it until I had a nice clean background, which is pretty cool. I have not tried Mask Prompter, or I know that there's a Segment Anything kind of thing out there. I can't remember what it's called. It might be called Segment Anything. To be able to grab different parts of a comp. And then the next thing that I had to deal with is the foreground cliff, which I wasn't liking. I was not having much fun with this foreground cliff. I didn't know exactly what to do because if you look at the footage, obviously there's we got the shadow across it and stuff. And in theory, he parks and stays here and the shadow is here. As the camera comes up, you see it at multiple angles. And so I did what is one of my favorite things to do, which is basically replaced that entire cliff right here with a photo scan element.
Oh, nice.
And so it's as simple as that. I just replaced the whole ground. And
is that so you can get the topography for your shadow?
I technically could, but really what it was is because I knew the camera move was dynamic enough that I couldn't quite use my trick of just exporting a still of the clean ground. I needed to move a little bit with the, you know, with the camera's geometry and have a little bit of bumpiness to it. Now, I haven't put the contact shadow back, and I should actually experiment with that because what I would likely do for it at this point, I rendered out Tom Cruise on a bike. Which I'll go into even more detail about.
Yeah, you got to talk about that bike. Some weird stuff. I still don't fully understand the bike.
All right, so I'll explain that right after this. So after this cliffhanger, I apparently say that word weird. I say what? I say cliffhanger instead of cliffhanger or something.
What do you say instead?
I say cliffhanger.
Cliffhanger?
Like apparently, no, I say it to, like, rhymes with anger when I say, like, a clothes hanger. But
many other people say
hanger versus hanger. And so, anyway, it's been pointed out to me.
I'm going to be honest. You just said that it sounds like you say it correctly. You're like, it rhymes with anger, like hanger. Like, that's literally the word. It's not cliffhanger.
That's true.
Cliffhanger is actually the star of my new television series.
Hanger management?
Hander. The hander. Yeah. All right. I'm sorry.
Anyway, what a fun detour.
All right.
So, yeah. So, through in a photo scan of a ground, there are some wonderful ones that you can get. This specific one was... do I still have it pulled up? Oh, no, I closed it.
How could you?
I'll find the name of that. So now you've got the foreground and the background, and now we've got to figure out how to have Tom Cruise fall off at the edge here, because...
It's a problem we always have.
You can see we have, he parks his bike very nicely there, but I wanted the bike to, like, have its, like, wheel spin and fall off and stuff. And so it meant that both Tom Cruise and the motorcycle need a digital double takeover at this point. And to do that digital double takeover, I am using some weird combination of camera projection tricks. So here's what I did. I went into Photoshop. So here's my Tom Cruise stunt double. It's pretty cool.
Looks pretty good. It looks like Mission Impossible 3 Tom Cruise, like breaking in to save Kerry Russell.
Yeah.
I just go into that theme regularly in my life.
And what did I find? I found that I know this is a motocross bike. I don't know exactly which bike it is, but I was able to. My goodness, where did I store it? I found this model of a Honda CRF 450. I don't know what that is. Don't ask me. Who does? But I found this model, and it's the right shape of the bike. Actually, I should open up the real model. I thought this was the earliest version of it I had, but maybe it's one of these back here. It's probably this. Here we go. So here is a model of a bike that I thought looked pretty similar, especially because I was comparing it to a little still that I exported. I just exported a still of the last frame, or actually not the last frame, but just a really good frame of the bike, you know, from the side angle. And then I'll show you some cool things. I was able to say, let's open up the newest Photoshop in the background here. But I exported the frame. Let's see where I saved it. Did I put this in renders or did I put it in here? Yeah, I put it in renders. So here is the image that I output of the bike. And clearly you can see if I zoom in, it's a little garbly. We've got, you know, it's compressed. It's a trailer still. And obviously Tom Cruise was sitting on the bike in reality. But the best thing about having fun tools like Adobe's Generative Fill is that you can open up things like that. And let's see, let's do a demo. Here we go. So here's the still that I grabbed. Oh, there's even a newer version of Photoshop. But either way, you can...
Since you last updated it this morning.
You can just do a quick little, you know, selection of Tom Cruise on the bike, like any Tom Cruise that you would like, really. And let's modify and expand that like 5 pixels. And then we'll click the generative fill button with no other information. And what do we got here? We have, there we go. Like perfectly. There are 3 variations and they're all great. Boom. So then I passed this bike through to an AI op-reser called Topaz, which gave me a higher resolution image of it like this.
And it took you higher, is what you're trying to say?
This Topaz can take you higher.
Nanner, nanner, nanner.
So I have to do it. So look at that. So we've got this nice, pretty perfectly side-on view of a motorcycle, which speaks both to the blocking and everything of the shot. So now that I have that, I decided that I would take this model, which is similar, and figure out a way to project the texture onto it. So my process was a little bit strange. I took the bike and I threw it inside a volume builder and a volume mesher inside of... Whoops, I didn't mean to turn the volume builder back on. Let me... What have I done? I've asked it to do too many things. Stall. What have I done?
Well, I'll go to here. This is what I've got what looks like a toilet bowl or a bedpan on Tom Cruise's. I've got GeoTracker.
Excellent. GeoTracker becoming very necessary part of our
Definitely
workflow. Oh,
crap, that's not. Go here. Boop 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 boop. And then I go up. All right, so it comes down like that. Now let's see. I've got to figure out. Once again, I have to make this look like it's sitting on his shoulders. So it blocks his head, but his shoulders are in front of it. God, this is tough.
I think I'm back. I might have frozen up there for a spell.
You did. You're back now.
Well, I'm back. Nothing is impossible. Thank you.
So what you want to do now that you're back?
So when I'm back, I am going to... I just force quit a couple of applications because I was running too many things.
Wait, I'm so dumb. I don't have to do anything. This is silhouette.
Hey.
Just go... Yeah. Fill.
You dummy.
Boop.
Yes.
Oh, my Lord. That's... Okay. Well, now I'm in trouble.
Okay.
But it was really hopeful for a second.
All you need is... Yeah, just Supercomp haze that thing.
All right, let's see. I'll figure this out. Let's see what happens if I just haze it. If I just make it do a series of embarrassing things to get into my club.
Exactly. I mean, I disagree with it in general. But
if you click haze, suddenly your footage will be unclothed and standing in front of some historic library. I don't know how college works. Let's do...
Hey, look at that.
Definitely want to add some noise now, some grain, turn you up to 100.
Mm-hmm. And also, we could use a little bit of motion blur.
Yeah, for sure.
I know that's often a last step, but...
This looks like garbage. Motion blur, yeah. Why don't I just do RSMB?
RSMB? We need an RSMB drop.
We do. It's not working for me lately. Why is that happening? One?
That is unusual.
Okay. Well, then I'll just use actual motion blur, like a chump.
Fine.
That works.
Hey, it does.
Now, it doesn't, though. Like,
wait, it shouldn't, right?
That's element. It's generated by element, so it works that way. So if I keyframe this haze... I mean, I'm still going to have to integrate it into the scene. Did you freeze again? Or are you still here?
I think I'm still here. I'm just trying to figure out what... I'm trying to close strategic programs without exiting this call.
Oh, I see. I mean, if you exit the call, you just come right back, you know?
That's true.
As long as you answer the call. Ghostbusters.
All right.
Ghostbusters Creed.
Ghostbusters Creed.
Ghostbusters Creed. Can you take the Ghostbusters higher?
I think as soon as we sang Creed on this, it really
it broke the stream. It ruined your computer and the show forever.
All right. So you keep the plane flying. I'm gonna reboot out of here and try to catch the plane mid. I had an analogy. I don't know.
Hey, you know what, bud? It's okay. We love you and get back safe.
I'll be back. I promise to get back safe.
Oh boy, am I back to doing a show by myself again? Nobody wants this.
Yes. Enjoy.
Leave. I'm just kidding. good luck. Mocha AE, GeoTracker. So the thing about me, if you guys haven't learned this from watching this show, is that something Hashi's very good at doing is narrating what he's doing and why he's doing it while he's doing it. I am good at doing each of those one at a time and never simultaneously. And so, and that's even a stretch. So, you know, why don't we go to some questions, actually? I realize I haven't checked in on the chat. Anybody asking anything? Mission Impossible Meltdown, I just see in all caps. That Ryan, thank you for screaming Writer's Room Game Show episodes at us. Look at Hashi, frozen in time. Oh! Laughter. I'm screenshotting. did it. Okay. Mask prompter is crazy good too. That's my gains. Okay, you've talked about the Hashi talked with this. Oh, I clicked the wrong screenshot. Here we go. Did I get it? I got it. Screenshotting things for the thumbnail. That Friday content to wear Phil Hosh, man, you gotta just calm down, man. I know you're happy. It's fun. That Friday content to wear feel keyframe the color picker. I'm just reading through all the comments here. Sample the original layer in RSMB. That's yeah, but isn't that what it already does? I don't know. Seth, you're doing great. Just throw some drops at us if you're unsure of what's next. You know what? That's a great idea. Why don't we just break into a... Well, no. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm above that. Guys, you don't need drops to feel... CC ball action! Okay. Anyway. But for real, learning. You know, I get paid for this, so why not? I've got to integrate. I'm going to do a very, very, very dreadfully crude mask around this. If you're wondering, if you're thinking, did Seth just forget what he was saying because he said crude and was trying to figure out how to turn it into a Tom Cruise pun, then you know me too well. Frigby, you're already at it probably. In fact, I would venture we probably need to make a graphic that's ongoing that's just a direct feed to Frig, that basically like a shortcut that I click on the Stream Deck and it will pull Frigby's latest comment and just put it on screen. Because you, sir, are ruining our show with fantastic puns. All right, so I've drawn this rough thing. Let's see how well it does. Beepity bobbity bib. It did great. Perfect. Okay.
It has been terminated.
He's back!
Okay. I am here and frozen in joy.
Still frozen in joy. Oh, now you're the letter S.
Hey,
Sesame Street, and now you're the letter Hashi.
Little Hashi reboot, and we're all back to normal. Hey, everyone. I'll get back to sharing.
Oh, they said it's grayed out.
Sharing and caring.
Does Mocha gray out? Can you see Mocha on screen?
Yeah.
I don't know what it's grayed out meant. Oh, well. So how you doing, pal?
I'm doing well. I feel like I was in the middle of maybe about to show how, I set up this bike for some texture projection, right?
I know, I was excited to learn.
All right, well, let's go back to learning a little bit about that. I will find these files.
Okay, let me know when you're ready, and I'll go straight to you.
What do we got? All right. Source. Doobie-doobie-doo. And
drawing masks around Tom Cruise. This is what I'm paid for. It's how I support my family by drawing masks around Cruise.
Excellent. So I think I've got everything loaded up over here.
All right, boom.
So check it out. See this crazy motorcycle? Well, it's not just a motorcycle. It's also my cinema 4D, where I am projecting the image from Mission Impossible onto this 3D model, which is kind of cool.
You are going to get the Simon shout out in the meeting this week, Hashi. Our boss Simon is going to go, when he talks about the things he loved in Chill, he's going to mention this right here, because this just got you your paycheck, dude.
Look at this. So how does camera projection work? Well, you see this camera that's right
I feel
here.
Like, I don't know.
Ask someone.
Ask Jonas or Darren.
Oh, my lovely dog has come by to see us.
Yay, Bumblebee.
Bumblebee.
Come back, Bumblebee.
We have a new puppy named Bumblebee. I might check to see if Bumblebee is supposed to be up here. And I'm going to leave you in suspense again.
That's
about
fine. Go right ahead. You showed off the cool motorcycle. People will wait for it. In the meantime, let's get back to my tracking, which everyone's very excited to learn about. I'm going to keep on moving these little dots here. Welcome back to the exciting world of mask tracking the wrong way with Seth Worley. What the hell am I even doing in this program? It's not doing at all what I want it to do. So I'm just manually adjusting it and talking like this for my own sanity. What the living hell? Seriously, this isn't even... Okay, maybe I need to think about this a different way. What if I kept doing what I was doing and didn't change course? Perfect. I hear sounds. Is he back?
What's up?
He's back! All right, talk about that motorcycle.
All right, so here's this motorcycle. So as I was mentioning earlier, I really wanted to have this motorcycle be some simplified geometry, so it was just a few little pieces that I was projecting this texture onto.
Peaches for free.
Peaches for free, millions of them. And
for me.
So here's how we set that up. So let's delete all this stuff.
Everything.
Fun. All right, so... to do a texture projection, you'll need a material. And for this, the material will need to be that image that we created. So you remember the image? Let's locate it real quick.
And
so
we can
pull it up big. Here we are. So yeah, so this image. So I wanted to have this image being projected onto this bike. And one of the easiest ways for me to see that it is actually being projected is by having a big stand-in plane in here. So,
like an airplane. Is,
so let me delete the material from these things. And then I'm going to go to this camera's view. So you see that? So you'll need a camera and you need a material. And you can put your framing in there. And so now that I have this, I could drag this to things like the plane surface, but look what's going to happen.
Do it.
It's weird. Like this doesn't look right. Same thing as if I drag this material over to the remesh. Let me see. Which of these are actually acting as the bike? Not this, not that. So just these two. So if I drag this texture over onto these, you can see what's happening is like something you might predict would happen is just weirdness. It's not really doing anything. But if I go to these material channels right here, this might be a little bit difficult to see with us, maybe not. If I select the material tag over here, you can see in the display settings, there is projection, which can be UV mapping, which is default, or you can choose camera mapping. Now, if you select camera mapping, it's going to look weird at first. Crazy moray pattern. But that's because it has no idea what camera. So what you're going to need to do is you need to fill in this camera field right here. So I'm going to drag this camera down to here and then let go. And now you see that I've got the camera projecting this thing to here. Right here under the film aspect ratio, it guessed 4:3, which is not correct. So I'm going to switch it back to 16:9, which is what the whole frame is, including the letterboxing. And once I do that, now you can see this background is pretty nicely lined up with where the bike is supposed to be. So now I could either do the same thing with both the settings of these materials right here, or I could actually clear them and just control copy over the material tag right here. And look at that.
Yay.
So the reason why this worked out is because when I created this camera and added this plane material with a camera projection, I did initially need to do a little bit of sliding around. So you can see if I move the camera around, it's literally affecting where the texture projects onto this 3D model. So you're going to want to have it as aligned as possible. And in this case, once I did have it pretty aligned, I did some things like modified and mesh brushed little bits of the mesh here. So you can see if I wanted to, I could like this front hood thing didn't really match from the other model. So I kind of bent it down to try to fit into there. Same thing for parts of the frame. I tried to adjust them and sort of moved this gobbledygook right here to line up there. And then eventually felt pretty happy with where I could tell the outlines of this were getting projected to. Also, within the projection settings, you can see down here, should it project to the front, the back, or both? I chose both, which if I leave my camera, one important thing is once you've set up projection mapping to a camera, you've got to leave that camera be. So you can either lock it by putting it in its own layer, or, you know, whatever your favorite method of locking is. I don't want to deal with it right now. I'm just going to go to a default camera.
Oh, wait, wait, locking? Are you locking the cameras over there?
I'm not. I'm not going to deal with it.
You should. Here's why you should. It's very simple. You ready for this? Tags.
Tags. You mean like saying...
Rigging.
My rigging tags? My
restrictions.
Protection?
Or protection. Protection. Protection.
Protection.
Boom. Done. Protection.
Restrictions.
It's locked. And you can turn on and off however you like.
Oh, there we go. So now I can't accidentally move this camera around. Look, it's perfect. The motorcycle stays right there. And if I click out of that camera,
there you go.
It leaves it there.
Learning.
And now you can see, like, this is a little wonky, you know, the way it wraps around here. But the point is, I knew that my motorcycle just needed to look just like the motorcycle from the movie, from this side. And then do that.
And then it just did.
And it just did. And I even went a few steps further with the motorcycle model. After I got to this point where everything was baked together, I realized I wanted the wheels and the handlebars to turn. So I dove in and did some selections and grabbed them. But anyway, that is how you do a texture projection. The next step of this, sorry to keep on adding on.
I'm going to go back and watch all this later.
You then want to... Like, say you want this now to be exported to a program of your choice. If you want to move this mesh around, it's not going to work anymore because watch.
Everybody move the mesh around. Sorry.
It just moves right through the texture, and that's not helpful to anybody. So that means that once it's locked and in this nice position like this, you want to take these objects and go to Object, Bake Object, where you can bake the texture and replace the objects if you want, and choose to render out a various resolution of these things. So if I wanted these to be, I don't know, 2048 or something like that big, I could choose that say, let's make it a JPEG and put it in this bandages folder. Why not? We'll select that and I'll say bake.
Bake.
It's going to think for a second.
So did you move the mesh around?
Of course I moved the mesh around.
Everybody moved the mesh around.
So down here, you can see that it's processing the automatic UVs, which means it's trying to take the camera projection and re-split up the model into a new thing. This process takes a teeny bit. And the result that you will get is something that looks like this. It reminds me a little bit of when you're working with a photogrammetry kind of deal.
I love photogrammetry deals.
Photogrammetry deals. Great deals on photogrammetry, everybody.
Great deals on photogrammetry.
So check this out. It's wild. So here's what it comes up with, because it's basically just trying to densely pack in all of the resolution of that motorcycle to all of the different little faces. But when it comes back from this baking, you'll have a new material here, and you will have these two new objects that take that material. I don't know if I should have checked single texture, to be honest. with when I had two things selected. I don't remember. We'll see. We'll see what happens. It might pack them properly, and it might be a little bit upset that I did that. Either way, it's still going.
Nice.
Processing. This processing part isn't going to be very fun. It's okay. But what is fun is seeing that once we got it in here, we've got a nice little bike animation where I could try to line up a frame as close as I could. Let's see if we can reveal what that looked like. So here is what I was able to come up with. For Tom Cruise, I did the same trick that we nearly always do, which is grab that Tom Cruise head scan, jam it onto an existing character from Mixamo, and doing a teeny bit of custom animation. In this case, it was like getting thrown from a punch or something, but I replaced the first opening keyframes with something that more closely resembled the pose that Tom Cruise was in before he gets thrown from like the horse or whatever this mocap file is supposed to be. So once everything is lined up, and we cover Mixamo animations a lot. We exported a sequence of OBJs, brought them into Element, and did all those kind of fun things until we end up with this little situation. Let me show the render itself. All right, so here's my rendered character. The bike has a texture projection on it, as you can sort of tell. The character doesn't right now. It's just the default Mixamo animation. And here's him falling off the bike. So a little bit boring. But to make this this transition a little bit more seamless, what I did is I added, right on top of this, I found the last frame of Tom Cruise that kind of lined up with this pretty well. So you can see it's a pretty close lineup if I turn this on and off. So here's real Tom Cruise plus bike, and here's the bike. So they're similar, and I could have color matched Tom Cruise better, but I didn't even bother because I knew I was going to do it this way. I added a liquify brush and put a keyframe on the distortion mesh, and then like would move a frame, and when it moved a frame, Tom Cruise, the CG Tom Cruise, moved up a little bit. So I took my liquify brush and just moved up that last good frame of Tom Cruise to kind of match it. And I did that over the course of 10 frames, just mush warped little bits of that. And so like that skin is still coming from a weird liquefied version of Tom Cruise as I turned down the opacity. And so what you get in the end is this smoothed out kind of thing where the transition point is pretty hidden.
That's nuts.
And
Rana said if you set your project render resolution first, I believe it will calculate the projection aspect ratio properly.
Oh yes, that's a good comment. And I'm going to open up. I forgot to open up our stream again.
There's a question about the other day where someone was working with Rotobrush for the first time and noticed they can't change their renderer from Mercury-only software. How to fix this? It's grayed out. I think that has to do with your machine
your display
specs,
adapter,
right?
I think. Yeah, what? I think so. Yeah. Yeah, I think that has to do with your machine specs and whether or not you have a graphics card that is compatible with replacing CPU calculation with GPU calculations. I don't
sure.
know. Sure. Why not? Probably. All right, so I'm going to get this
playing again. Check in for me. I've got.
Oh, please.
It's looking all right. I mean, I can smooth out the integration a little bit more in the haze, but I don't know if it's really reading as a neck brace as much as I wanted it to, so I could scale it or make it taller.
Interesting. One thing that I would consider doing as a cheat in this is I would have the neck brace be sampling, like be basically a mat for a clone stamp of his back just slightly lower.
Oh, that's interesting and really smart. Animal.
Like the collar,
so that's a freaking brilliant idea. I'm going to do it right now and teach everyone as if I made it up. So, guys, this really cool trick that I do all the time is I add a thing called Spot Clone Tracker. And I drop this spot clone. I'm going to have to track something to make this happen, aren't I? I can't really track his back. You're making track his back again, aren't you? Why don't I track his head?
Or you can throw a temp texture on your element layer, which you've tracked. Or can you parent it to the like the two comp position of your null of your geotracked thing?
Yes. Yes, you freaking brilliant man.
Use any data you have.
Watch this. Okay, so
I work harder.
We're gonna double click on the spot center, and right here I'm gonna pick whip this to I'm gonna create a new let's see, so I've got a null. Making one more null. This is going to be my spot null. And I'm going to make it 3D, and I'm going to hold down shift while I pick whip it to the object track null, which is his pick head track. Pick whip
it good. Look at that.
Then I'm going to position it down to here. And then I'm going to do this little number where I find my spot clone here, and I'm going to... Actually, I'm going to go alt click. I'm going to pick whip to the layer, to that null itself, to that spot null. Let go. I'm going to do dot two comp with a capital C, parentheses and in parentheses. I believe a zero, brackets with three zeros. And now this spot clone track, this spot should be tracked with wherever that null is, which it is. Now, if I bring this up, oh, wait. No, Seth, you dummy, I had it all backwards. Instead, let's just change that to be... What am I gonna do? Sorry, guys. I had it backwards. I needed to follow the head. So I'm going to drop this onto the object track, keeping the two comp expression. And now, spot clone tracker is tracking... the head, and should be replacing it with anything that is right here. Now, why can't you see it? Well, let's go over here and let's just do straight clone. And now you're going to see it's following, you know, wherever that spot is.
Yes.
Now I'm going to put that spot, as Hashi suggested, on his back, and I'm going to make this spot friggin' huge. Hashi, this was such a smart idea. Spot. You freaking idiot. It's such a smart idea. So, Hashi and I love each other very much.
Spot clone man.
Spot clone man. And then I'm going to say rendering options, render on transparent.
Ooh.
I mean, I don't need to, but I'm gonna. And then I'm going to say set. No. Yeah. Set mat. My element layer, effects and masks. And I'm going to go to element, and I'm going to say, get rid of the fill, and it's just going to be. So now, if I turn off, okay, my God, I can't believe this is going to work. If I go in here, turn off element, put this new thing here that we made, it should now match the black values of the jacket. And it mostly does. That looks pretty cool. Now, why isn't it? All right, so one trick we can do. I need to label things. This is not my... This is my shoulders. This is my neck brace. It's 110. I want to move to a more fun shot. I'm going to give him a black eye in a second.
Ooh, excellent.
Neck brace, and I'm going to make this spot. I'm not going to match the spot size.
Good thinking.
I'm going to make it smaller and put it more right here. And match spot color. Here we go. Turn that up to like something 29. How's that? Whoa, it did something. Repair, clone, texture clone, fill. No.
In case you ever need it, there is a lovely tutorial on Cineversity, getting started with Spot Clone Tracker. hosted by one of us. I don't remember which one.
Oh, who did that?
I don't remember.
Didn't you? Because you did the dogs. You did the dogs.
Oh, yeah. The creepy dogs.
Creepy dogs.
Yes.
Man, this is a good idea, but I don't know if I'm loving it.
I'm not either. It felt like it would work.
Is the repair like on work. There? Huh?
Is the repair or match spot color turned up? I wasn't really paying attention.
I did some stuff. I mean, there's repair. There's... And with like match spot colors turn, all the way up.
I was going to turn it all the way down.
Yeah. But, that, I mean, that's kind of basically what clone is. And
yeah, good point.
And it kind of stays dark why for too this, long.
It's so weird. Why does it stay dark?
Because it's dark down here.
And but it's not that dark. Is this the chessboard illusion?
What if I do a... What if I make the spot size even smaller? Wow, it does not like that.
I feel like something's weird.
Something is weird. Stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody know what's... Look what's going down. In spot clone tracker. What the freaking heck? Move. There. So... I could do it right there. It's still too dark. But what I could do is maybe then put a haze on it.
Good work.
It's okay. You can just keep matching it.
Meh. You can go. You can move to something more fun. Like, we know we can get this to work, but maybe it's not good television.
You know what? It's not good television.
As I always am saying.
All right. Moving to... What are you doing?
I've just opened up this shot, Moto Jump 1.
Oh, nice. So, well, here's what I'm letting everyone know. I'm going to add a black eye to Tom Cruise. You got something you want to take over and do for a little bit before I do that?
Sure. So I am going to, I'm jumping straight to the finale because we had some ideas for what the finale of this would be, which is all of the above, all of the accrued injuries all together, but somehow like he's going back, he's getting back on the horse, back on the motorcycle to face this, stunt that he botched right at the beginning of this trailer, because Ethan doesn't give up. He cares more about your life than his own, clearly. So I just really quickly roto-brushed Ethan out of that shot, and then I'm going to put the background back. I'm going to pre-compose. Actually, I'll check the use motion blur, and then I'm going to pre-compose this layer so I can have it be more clearly Ethan, bike, and then we'll... move all of the attributes over so I can just have a nice baseline right here of the bike itself. And then for just a moment, I'm going to set it as a mat for this layer right here. And not a Luma mat, but an inverse alpha mat. And as I play through, let me see how well that seems to cover them up. Seems pretty good. I can use the content aware fill alpha expansion to make sure that it goes a little bit wider than these spots, or I can use a matte choker or something on this layer itself. Sometimes I do a combination of both because I don't know why. I don't know if one is better than the other, but for the fill method, we're going to use object, and I'm just going to say generate layer. I think this shot is only 1 second long, so 24 frames, so it'll analyze pretty quickly here. And then once it's analyzed, it's going to fill it up, baby. Fill it up! All right. There we go. There's the empty plate for this shot. And the reason why it's nice to have an empty plate is I'll now kind of combine these two. I don't need the mat anymore, so I'll disable it. From here, no more mat. And then I'll grab this fill layer and put it down at the bottom. And then we'll precompose these two things together. So we'll precompose this as the, what shot is this? 4040 BG. Excellent. So now we have the background and Ethan on a bike like that. And this is something that often happens, especially on the first frame of content-aware fill. We've got a little bit of a pretty visible matte expansion issue going on here. So I'm going to dive into the pre-comp that has that fill layer right here, wherever we put it. And then on this fill layer itself, let's just go in and add a matte choker. Whoops. Matte choker. And then we'll turn up the gray level softness.
It meets the eye.
But, and the geometric softness, and then the amount of choke. Let's turn up a bit. Turn that down. Somewhere around here. So the difference is, let me see. So this kind of a sharp line, or a little bit of a more feathered line there. And I might try to do maybe two iterations of it to smooth this out a little bit more, try to feather it a little bit better. It's got to feather it to the point where it's not showing the inverse matte blur. There we go. This is a little bit better, I think. And let's see how it looks in. It's a little bit silly. I don't know why that's bothering me so much. All right, well, let's have it choke in a little bit further then. I want to obviously cover up Ethan, but I don't like the way this is working out. Here we go. So this should be helpful because one of the things I'm going to do is I want to add some things around Ethan. One idea is to add that he somehow secured the IV.
Oh, 100%.
To the motorbike just behind him, and 100%. It'll be, you know, like bouncing and rattling. And then for this leg, I think I would like to put it in a full cast and have it sticking straight forward, which means it will need to delete his leg from this section. And I love that I just have moved to saying delete like pieces of footage. But it is something that I'll need to do. So to do that, I'll kind of take a look at this plate and try to figure out what would be a good way to do it. And actually, Spotclone Tracker might be a good way for me to do this leg removal. Watch this.
Wow, you and your Spotclone Tracker today.
This is very, very silly. I'm just going to do Spotclone Tracker, and then we'll go ahead and grab a sample from right here on the motorcycle, and we'll move it. Oh, whoops. I did this backwards. Let's move the sampling over here. Look at that.
Look at that.
There's a foot there, and now there's just motorcycle garbage.
I think that's
what it's officially called. Just, you know, motorcycle garbage.
Mission
there.
Impossible motorcycle garbage.
So I'll center it on this, like, Nike swoosh looking thing, and I'll dial up this so it looks like you can see that part of the leg, but no leg and foot down here. And then I'll just say track. I'm just going to, I'm at the end already. So let's track backwards. Sorry. Backwards.
That looks like you just gave him a Nike sneaker.
It really does. Like that hidden swoosh in there is.
Now you have to paint the swoosh out. And like pinstripe blazer, like pinstripe pants.
Definitely.
Which go well with Nike sneakers.
Okay, so now with that's tracked, one thing I could do is I can at any time just move the where this is coming from.
Whenever you
want. Look at that.
Look at that. There it is.
The front of the bike
looks like Lieutenant Dan'd him.
I did. See? And now we've got Ethan stumps here. Look at that. See, what? Like, I was going to, like, maybe patch and track and,
no,
like, paint the thing and all
worked.
That, but no.
Simon's going to love that one, too.
The I'm going to turn down the match spot color a little bit. Bring in the shape a little bit. And this is great. Like, look, it really actually is very Lieutenant Dan.
I need to make a drop of Simon Walker's head coming up with heart eyes, like twinkling anime style at the screen whenever something like this happens, when we use a red giant tool.
We absolutely do. And in fact, like, maybe what we could use would be, let's see.
I'm about to make an audience member of ours very happy in a second by misusing their product.
I think that we could use this Simon Walker Cheers illustration.
Perfect. two drinks.
So when we get to making that drop,
it'll three be drinks, like, actually, if he's drinking
three
that
drinks,
one.
Yes. If you ever meet Simon Walker in person and enjoy some drinks with him, you will hopefully get to be part of his famous photographs through a beer glass, which I think is what this was trying to emulate. But in person, they're much more exciting.
Nice. All right. Speaking of exciting, everyone, let's give Ethan Hunt a black eye, if you will, but the new fashioned way. So,
you know, the last person to give Ethan Hunt a black eye was probably Superman.
We can do it the easy way or the hard way. I'm going to do the easy way by, I'm going to drop a little thing on this plate called Lockdown.
Lockdown. Thanos in the house.
I'm going to click pop out. And then I'm on a Mac. So I'm going to hold down command.
Track it.
Going to click some crap on his face, hoping that it will track. Just gonna doobity doop. Already, Chris is just like, oh God, no. Why are you doing this? This is the wrong.
You're not hired to be the official voice of
of Chris's grief.
You use this thing. So I was gonna, you know, lock, pop it open, put some shit around it. Bing, bing.
So, trackety track all. Did I just track his face? I literally did. Now, look how pissed he is about it. He's got dots on his face. So, a couple things I'm gonna do now. First, I'm going to go up to this I, and I'm going to say unified plane. And that is how it's going to interpolate points that I put here now that I'm not going to track. I'm just going to put them here because I'm a weirdo.
Don't you have to, like, control shift click there so they're a different looking color?
Oh, is that what you're supposed to do? I just don't track them. So command shift, control shift.
One of those.
None of it's happening. I don't know.
It's some combination of things.
Well, none of it's happening for me.
Veranos,
what should I click for the unified, for the interpolated things? I just always do just more tracks and don't track them.
That's clever.
Is that right?
It's like, and I press the brown lock button. Yeah, I don't know.
Can't look at the comments without, let's see.
Not control.
Command, shift, alt, click on Mac. Command, shift, alt. Okay, here we go. Command, shift, alt. I don't have these fingers. Boom, boom, boom.
Those are the ones. Boom, those boom, are the ones that get interpolated boom, like a plane.
Boom. That looks good enough for me. Then I'm going to say auto triangulate. And now Tom Cruise has some geo on his face. Beep, bop, boop. Now.
Beep, beep, beep. You got something on your face, Tom.
Tom, duh. Now, all right. So
I know that I'm very colorblind, but this really does truly look like the Rick Astley music video to me. Just this shot.
I don't know if
I'm way off.
No, it's, I see it. If I were to desaturate it, I could totally see it. It's the, it's the newfangled version. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm going to say, just cause I want to set lockdown mesh UV frame. I don't have to do it, but I'm a control freak. So I do it now. X out. And I'm just going to click this button that says lockdown. Cause it has an exclamation point. Chris is out there like, why are you being
that
weird
sound in the product settings?
Yeah. Uh-huh. So now he's got a checkerboard on his face. And if I want to, I can double click in here. I can turn that checkerboard off. And now this is fun. I've got his eye there, right? So here's some fun stuff I could do. I am going to paint a black eye onto this man, and I'm going to do it the craziest way I know how.
Please do.
Which I'm just going to paint on here. Like this. Ready?
What?
Yeah. I'm going to click the paint brush tool. I'm going to double click on this layer, and I'm just going to start painting. I'm going to say mode is set to multiply. Opacity at 26%. I'm going to pick like a purpley-ish color, super dark.
Uh-huh.
Maybe a little more desatted and darker. And I'm going to go and I'm going to start just painting some Tom Bruise. In fact, but Tom Bruise is actually the name of Tom Cruise's new IPA that he's excited for you to try.
Tom Bruise.
Tom Bruise.
sorry. It's flawless. Flawless. Please enjoy.
Why has no one made Tom Bruise before? Bottles of Tom Bruise. Okay. Tom Cruise's Tom's Bruises. So I'm going to keep painting some black eye-ness on the guy. And I think if I go a little bluer and a little darker, and I go boop and a boop, maybe that's too much up here. Do some more in there. Right here, that's too much. So now he's got a black eye. And if I play this back, you'll see it suddenly comes on. That's because in my paint effects, I've got to take these layers and drag them all. Oh, there we go. Now, one thing I can do here is there's a couple ways that I can integrate this into the scene. And I think the simplest way is going to be for me to... So if I bring it back in here into the... let me unlock this. If I go back into the main composition, you can't see it. And that's because I painted it onto a guide layer. So a couple things I can do here. I can turn that off, not be a guide layer anymore. And I bring it in here, but it's now got this like halo around it, this kind of matte line.
Mm-hmm.
I could, if I wanted to, I believe it's right here. So if I drop like a matte choker, that'll get rid of the matte line. And now he's got a black eye on his eye. Or I could go back into here and set the paint to a paint on transparent, set it to on. Now he's all purple. And I go in here and I can set this lockdown layer that it's got here, and I can set it to multiply on top of the layer, which maybe I'll do that. But now I've got, now Tom's got a black eye, but I want to put some other stuff on him, right?
Slowly dripping blood out of the corner of his mouth.
I'm going to start with, I've got that butterfly band-aid that we, band-aid.
That is an action movie staple. If you haven't been, you know, in an action movie with a butterfly band-aid over your split brow, were you really trying?
Butterfly band-aid. Where did I save the butterfly band-aid? What? Am I in the wrong folder?
Don't go chasing butterfly band-aids.
Did I put it in here? Am I going crazy, Hush?
I feel like you would have put it in there, and I can't imagine you naming it anything other than butterfly.
Butterfly band-aids! Butterfly, oh, spoilers for my movie. Butterfly bandage. I don't know where I saved it to. In Spider-Verse, it's in the wrong week. Okay.
In Spider-Verse.
So,
oh, every morning,
I could just bandage. drop it into here. But the problem is, I want to put it like, do I want to put it on his eye? So here's the thing. If I put it here and I put it like, up on his eyebrow.
There you go. There's the classic.
It's unfortunately going to come in multiplied on his face. So I could turn
what are you gonna do?
Paint on transparent back off. I could turn and come back in here and turn off multiply and add that matte choker. I want, has Chris spoken out yet about a better way to do this in the comments? But I've got
But you did just teach Chris about the paint on transparent option, which is in its own software, but just learned today.
It's actually After Effects.
Oh, that is After Effects.
Yeah. But so I could do this, or I could really do this, honestly, if I wanted to. The thing is, I don't like how that's integrated. I kind of want to make a separate version. I want to make it a separate layer, the butterfly band-aid. Now, one thing I haven't even talked about is instead of lockdown, if I wanted to, I could also...
Oh, I know where we're going with this.
Yeah, so I could also use After Effects' face tracker. So actually, I can just get a... not rounded rectangle, an ellipse tool, and just be like, here's a face. And then go to tracker. face tracking detailed features. And track it.
Track it.
And now I've got his face tracked with these detailed face trackers. Now here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn off the mask. I'm going to turn off Jim Carrey's The Mask. I have it playing during every show off to the side. It's a smoking movie, guys. I'm going to take this now. And I'm going to alienate as many of our viewers as possible with references to Jim Carrey's The Mask. I'm going to apply... No, not to this yet. I'm going to apply to the butterfly band-aid. The butterfly band-aid. Weekend something. I know how the Rat song actually goes. Butterfly kisses. And
weird song.
Yeah, weird song.
Scale I was going to say officially weird.
Kissing my daughter and singing about it tenderly. Let's see. I'm going to apply an effect, a preset that I made called SOB to the bandage. And then I'm going to say, hey, bud, use this background layer where my face track is as the reference for where you should be. And I think if I did it right, which it seems to be weird, it should. What? Never mind. Don't do this because the face track isn't very good. So SOB didn't work, but that's one SOB. Let me tell you what might work. Putting it back into lockdown. Or I can use any of these facial track points. Right eye outer? Is that what that is? Let me move it. Nope. It is from the person's perspective. So the left eye outer is that one. I can track it to... That, let me do a null object, position, let's pick whip it to left eyebrow outer, and then let's parent the butterfly bandage to it. All right, it's not the best track. The face, After Effects' face track didn't give me a very significant track. So why don't I just put it back into lockdown? In fact, I could just do another lockdown. Can I do it? Chris, can I do another lockdown in the same thing?
Oh, I've done it. I'm pretty damn sure you can.
Lockdown graphics comp. Oh, I could literally just dupe this and dupe this, but go reveal layer source and project, dupe it in the project window, so it's actually duplicated. Ooh. Hold Alt, drag it onto there, and then go to, let's see, I'm going to say this is Tom Cruise. This one's going to be Tomerfly Band-Aids in the Weekend Nights. I don't know what the lyric actually is. And set that to be this new one that I did. And I'm going to go in, I'm going to turn off the paint. Spider-Man, turn off the paint. And set this back to be a guide layer. And bring my butterfly band-aid back in. Put it where I want it. How big are these things? Like that big or smaller?
They're about that big. I think that they have a variety of sizes. There, I think, looks a little bit better.
Go back in here, boom, boom, boom. It's two separate layers. I got my Tomerfly Band-Aids and the Weekend Nights and my Tom Cruise.
Ooh, I love it. Yes.
So.
I'm liking Tom Cruise.
Me too. So I think what I'll do, I'm going to integrate this into the shot. If I can, just bring it all into... Soups comps.
That's a good idea.
And say, hey, bud, why don't you match my... Oh, no. Never mind.
What have you done?
Apparently Siri responds to, hey, bud. That's new.
Oof.
Ah, match background didn't work. And that's because it's just one.
Well, there are some settings there to like decide how much you're using the white point as an influence or black point as influence.
Oh, right.
So you could dial up the white points percentage, which is usually lower influence.
Do I want the white points? Because it looks like it's just going to turn it orange.
Well, it would just turn it orange.
I feel like color correction is not going to do me much. Like automatic. What it's going to do well is if I just lean it any which way. Let's turn down the white levels a bit. Let's figure out what it is I want to do here. It's also very sharp. So let's do a little something called a fast box blur set to 0.1 maybe. And then give it a RSMB.
It works. Real smart motion blur.
That's real smart. All right. So that's feeling good. So we've got him bruised. Like, he needs some more stuff. So, oh, he needs the neck brace. That's right. I forgot he still has
the neck brace. Oh, yeah, the neck brace. So do you have you done a proper GeoTrack on this one yet?
I have not. I should do it, shouldn't I?
All right, you do a GeoTrack. I'm going to show off a little something that I was enjoying. Let me see. Where did I save this? I saved it under probably Lig. Here we go. So I want to have, this looks a little strange right now. This isn't what it looks like. It's going to become Tom Cruise's broken leg hanging out the front here. And the reason why I'm doing 3D is because I feel like there would be a little bit of 3D parallax. I bet I could also just stick a photo on there.
You really could. I don't know why I get such a kick out of Lieutenant Dan motorcycle shot. Oh, there. Like how you Lieutenant Dan did. Like it looks...
It is bizarre how well that works.
You're giving him a bare foot? That's so good.
Oh, yeah. He's going to have a bare foot.
Oh, my gosh.
But it's going to be wrapped in a cast. Now, there were a couple of models of like a foot in a cast, but I didn't really want to use them. I want to use my own, basically, which is I liked the way this foot looks. And I'm going to just quickly align it so I can stick it on the edge of this, or on the end, rather, of this leg. Let's sort of line these up to the best of our abilities, or the worst of our abilities, I don't know.
That's what this show is all about.
It kind of is. So let's just say, I don't know, this is a kind of slender leg for this specific foot.
Slender leg.
I just want something that's mildly lined up because I'm going to wrap the leg in a cast in just a moment here, which is going to be fun. So I'm going to show you how I would plan to do that. Now, you could just, you know, texture over this thing with a proper, you know, wrapped cloth-looking thing that has normals and whatever that match that. But I'm going to go a very different route. But I think it'll be fun. Okay, how's this? Are my proportions just absurd? Yeah, they are. Sorry. I guess I should have matched the
foot
size.
This is a very clever way to find... It. Yeah, never mind. Go ahead.
What are we talking about? So I don't really even need the foot from this one. And so what I'm going to do is I want to delete all of the points under here. So one way you can do that is if I was in solo mode is I could go to the ring selection. Actually, I go to polygons and see if a ring selection will grab any of these. Okay, no. How about a... Oh, no, I mean, there we go. Are any of these... Really, none of these are rings? Fine, I'll just do it with the lasso tool, whatever.
Ted Lasso tool.
Ted Lasso tool. Valentina has a great beat about the Ted Lasso tool. So let's do that, and we'll turn this foot back on, because I just like what a vulnerable-looking like foot this is. It's great. So let's take these and stick them together by doing... What should I do? I'll grab the the grab tool for this mesh, and I'll just... It's not even connected to itself. That's why it's horrible. You got to stay connected.
You got to keep them not separated.
All right. So now this leg is all connected up. So if I move a piece, all the others move with it too. So I'll use this grab brush and I'll just say kind of fit here. I'll stretch back the leg. And just line it up a little bit. It doesn't need to be great. Just, you've seen my sculpting techniques. They gave us that horrifying Tom Cruise and our horrifying heads whenever we appear in this show. Okay, here we go. We got a leg now. So let's grab these two things and I'll put them in a little group. And then I'll take the group and elevate it, you know, for some kind of... health reason, I'm sure. My dad, who's a doctor, is probably like, I wasted so much. All right, so we got this realistic foot. We've got this not realistic leg. But now I'm going to do this, which is I'm going to grab a... Oh, Seth, I have an even different idea.
Yeah?
I'm going to try something fresh. Fresh, fresh. Okay, let's create a... what is it? A spline. Let's, how do I do it? I guess I could go to the commander, maybe.
Commander, where is the spline?
Wait, I don't want to create a spring. I want to create a helix. Okay. So, did it create one? No, create a helix. There Science. We go. So I've created this helix around the leg. Okay. Let's save this because who knows if this will work. But we'll grab the helix and we will say, let's go to its object properties. Let's have the start radius be a little bit smaller like this or so. And you see that I want it to basically surround this leg. And then I'm going to go to the end radius and turn that down a bit. I'm going to make... its height a little bit taller because I want to make it almost all the way to the foot. And I want it to be more, to go around more. So let's change the end angle to more than 720. Let's dial this up. Now we have a good proper bunch of around kind of things. So let's make the radius a little bit bigger at the end and at the beginning because I want it to not be in contact with the leg at first, okay? So there's that. Now, we're going to go over here to, gosh, I really hope this works. It would be really fun if it did. Let's go to let's create a sweep object. Boop. And then we'll just create one little teeny segment right here. Let's just go to the pen tool again and just go boop, boop, like that. Just a little line, okay? So we'll throw that little line in the sweep object, and then we'll put the helix under that. Look what we got! We got a thing.
Look at that!
No idea why it did that though. Is it because it's off centered or something like that? That feels very silly to me. That I need to. Oh yeah, I guess it is that it's off centered. I thought that it didn't really care. Fine. Let's. Object, let's grab that sweep, and there we go. Let's center it among itself a little bit. I just needed to move its axis center to being in the center again. So now we have this thing that wraps around the leg like that. But I want to see what direction would be helpful. Probably on this sweep itself, we could say it should be banking, which is great. You know, this may be all I really need for what I'm hoping. So I created this crazy spring and this spline itself could probably be bigger. Let's see if we make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so now we've got all these things. And I'm gonna turn this whole object into a cloth object. I think I can just do it right to the sweep, right? I can go to simulation tags and say that it's cloth now. And to the leg itself, I can say simulation tags. You are now a collider object. I think that'll propagate to both of those. And now, if I go to my cloth properties, I'm going to turn up the stretchiness, but turn down the bendiness, because I don't want it folding exactly. I want it maintaining some of the smoothness of it going around. But then I want to go to the target length here and turn the target length down to maybe 60%. So instead of wanting to be this big, it wants to be 60% this size. I'm also going to do one additional thing, which is Command-D, go to your project settings, and I'm going to go to the simulation tab, and I'm going to turn up my substeps in iterations just a teeny bit, smoothing iterations a little bit, a couple more collision passes, and then in the scene itself, I'm going to turn off gravity, because I don't need gravity for this. I hope this will do this. Are we ready for the reveal if this works or not? And let's press play. Almost! Oh, it tried so hard.
Oh.
Okay, there's a lot of maybe self-colliding going on. Let's see. What do I need? How much did it have to do with overlapping? Let me just check if it's the overlap issue or if it's a sampling issue. Oh, maybe there's not enough tension in this thing. Well, heck. Though, look at this art piece right now. This is an NFT that I'm now selling. It's called Unbound. Everyone?
Okay.
Heard it here first.
A millionaire.
All right. So, okay. Helix didn't work. What if... can the helix connect back to itself? I don't know. This is going to be so cool. Anyway, let's hide this sweep for now and not deal with the clothness of it. What I really wanted to show off was that you could basically do things like this. Like you could add a cylinder, turn off the caps here, go to the object itself, make sure it has a good number of subdivisions, something like this. Change the height down like this. We'll rotate it like this around this leg. And now if we add a cloth tag, we can go to simulation, cloth, turn up the stretchiness, turn down the bendiness, and turn down the target length. And then when I press play, watch. Oh, come now. Seth, why did I have this working so well only to fall so far? Okay, fine. Now I've got to figure out why it's not working well enough for me. Okay. Cylinder, how many divisions does it have? Do I have too many pieces? Is it thinking too hard? Just wrap around this leg. Is it? I don't like what's happening. Maybe I need to put the collision tag independently on these two things instead of on the parent group, because maybe it's averaging their sizes or something. Was that it? Were you averaging their sizes? Tell me.
Were you? Tell me.
Maybe. Okay. It's trying. This is weird. Seth, this is not the result I was getting earlier with this experiment, and I'm not liking it. Let's see. Let's go to my cloth settings again. I'm going to delete that other one. Moment. Actually, no. I'm going to increment and save away from the other one. Now I'll get rid of it. And then we'll look at this thing and see if the target length should be that high or not. Press play. This is bizarre. Well, I totally took up way too much time showing off something that didn't work very well.
That's okay.
Well, you see, like, I'm going to load up this just as an example. So we wanted to wrap Tom Cruise in bandages for this process, and we looked up a few head casts. I didn't really like what they were doing. So instead, I dove into here and grabbed this secondary stand-in model of Tom Cruise that we have, the Sam Rockwell edition, and added a cylinder of cloth. I'll turn on the poly so you can kind of see I tried to make it so the polys on this cylinder were pretty square and nicely distributed. And then I made Tom a collider object and the cylinder a cloth object. I turned off the gravity and made its target length 66%. And now when I press play...
Whoop.
What is that? Shrinks right to Tom, just like that. And then I can pause. I can right-click on this thing and say current state to object. It makes a new object, which I can delete the velocity and cloth tag from and just leave it there, and maybe even copy over the collider tag. Because if I go back to the start frame, I'll have this loop again. And now I can move this cylinder to a different angle, like this. Let's move it up. And then I'll press play again. And it'll just elastic itself right onto this model, which is great. So here's what I was hoping to show off earlier. And in fact, you could even, if I were back on my first frame, if I had several copies of this. Let's see, let's move one here, let's move one here, and one here. And you could kind of angle them maybe a little bit differently, scale them differently. And then press play. And these will all try to reach their target length of wrapping around your object, which is pretty cool. So this is what I was really hoping that Helix would do, is that it would sort of do this. But I'm guessing that because the Helix wasn't contained, we were ending up with, you know, it...
You got to contain like your Helix. Like, it would pull
itself tight, but then... But with these rings, they can... They're all pulling each other to stay tight. With the Helix...
Got to stay tight.
They all compress for a second, but then they start to unravel because there's no tension on the end. And I suppose that I could have probably locked down a few points of the Helix, and so they would be tightening within each other, which now I kind of want to do. Okay, where did I save it? I saved it as leg two. I had the sweeps still here. Okay, so let's disable that and show this sweep again. Okay, we'll show the sweep. And now if I had on the... this cloth tag, what would I need to do? I would need to say... I would probably need this whole thing to be an object first, huh? So we'll press C to make it an object. And then we would add a cloth tag. And then to this cloth tag, we would go select a couple of points from it. We'd select these two points at the far end here, and these two points at the other end. I'm sure there's an index way to have selected those. But I'm going to grab those points, select them, and on the cloth tag, I'm going to go... mix animation with pins. Don't I just do that? No. I need to do a cloth belt. What am I trying to do here? Seth, I feel like I've gone off the rails trying to do something that I don't really know how to do.
That's what you're supposed to do on the show.
That's true. Belt on...
Because I've been sitting over here working points, way too Seth. Long on a freaking... This neck brace was a bad idea all around.
It seemed like such a good idea.
It did. Well, I didn't realize how hard it would be. I don't like things
that are really hard. That is the story. Like, that is the story of the show. Is
we not thought really it'd be just stupid to do,
but trying anyway.
Yeah.
So we tried it anyway, and I like that.
We tried it anyway.
Okay, let's see. Now, did this do anything? What happened? Now, yep, no idea what I've done. I don't need to be out of that and into object mode. Play. I've messed it up forever. I'm so sad. But anyway, do this version.
You were doing it a lot during the outright cylinders. Before the show.
I know. I was doing all of these kind of crazy mummy wrap things to end up with a thing.
Have you shown them what you ended up with?
Yeah, we ended up with open project. I probably called it Elements 3D Stuff Tom. What do I have called it? Bandages, etc. Nope. Bandage textures? No. Oh, maybe it was in my miscellaneous data because I made it earlier. Bandages. I don't even know. It's called Tom Bandages. Maybe it's my recent still. Tom Bandages 4. There it is. Yeah. So just doing that a bunch of times. Every time I let them stretch tight, I move the collider tag to them so they become another collider. So each of these steps up and up and up. And then once I was done, I put all of these cylinders, which had zero dimension, inside a thicken object and gave it a teeny bit of thickness. So it'll have a little bit of definition. This is a temp texture, by the way. I would use a different material on it. But we sort of know that it would wrap Tom Cruise like this. Which this is for which shot? Is this for the My Life Will Always Matter?
Yes, Hunter, and everything after. Like the motorcycle should have it.
Mm-hmm. So like, yeah. So when we're in here, what I could do is we could do something like this where we just grab a still frame of this. Just slot it right onto there. I feel like that would work.
Do it.
Okay, wait, let's save this. I mean, I guess I could generate it in here. Let's dive into here. Let's go to, I mean, how much time we got left? Oh, we got 2 minutes left. This is
wow, silly. That's it?
We got 2 minutes left, and I never got to show the crazy IV either.
Aw, you got
to spent too much time on my silly trying to wrap a leg with a bandage, and it did not work after all anyway. So just goes to show, never try to help anyone with a bandage unless you know what you're doing. I think that's fair advice, right?
Oh, of course.
Miscellaneous data, cervical collar textures. Where do you suppose I would have saved this? Tom Bandages. Where did I say you, Tom Bandages? Sounds more and more like a name.
It does. Hey, speaking of Tom Bandages, does he need more here?
Oh, that's pretty good, actually. Like one, like maybe like a forehead wrap would be kind of funny.
Yeah, it would be. Do you have a loose forehead wrap somewhere?
Yeah, it's in the, if you dive over into Element, we have, it's under bandages, etc., and it's called eye bandages.
Let's see. I'll do the same. Elements.
Right now, I don't know where my Tom Bandages is. file project. It's under miscellaneous data. Ethan 3. Jeez.
What? Elements, 3D stuff.
Data, head, Ethan 3, Tom Bandages. There you are. Goodness gracious. St. Ignatius. Okay, so now.
Does eye bandages, does it have any, I have a feeling that none of it's editable. It's all, if it's not editable, it doesn't have a UV and therefore won't come into Element with anything.
Oh, it should have had a UV.
Let me see. Open. Eye bandages. Oh, you know why? It's not, I didn't make it available offline. My bad.
There you go. Okay, let's see. Here's Tom's head. And let's, I'm going to do this a really cheap way. Let's see. Let's look at this. He's very front lit. Okay. And layer, new, light, spotlight, perfect. Big old spotlight. And let's add a camera, rotate this head to the right angle-ish. This is definitely how you should do your 3D work. Just do it in a totally different comp, scale it down, and connect it to a null track to the head. Okay, let's see. Let's get a slightly better angle on the head here. Seth, even just this is with no color correction at all.
Oh my gosh.
Let's see. I don't know how much motion blur there would be on this, but this could be a good way to go out. See, we've got this, and I'm so mad about the broken leg thing. Leg cast image. There's got to be something. Here we are.
Wait, so should this be over the bandages you made? Eye bandages. They're supposed to be over an eye. Okay, never mind.
I mean, you can. I felt like you'd be able to just like rotate them around or whatever.
Yeah.
It's too like two bands just wrapped like that. Okay. Stick with us, everyone. I'm just doing one last thing. Oh, the lighting on this is so poor. It's so bright. Let's grab this cast and these toesies. That. Let's jump in here. Let's shift the edge inward and reduce chatter, which smooth it out a little bit. Let's crop this down so it's just this leg. Crop.
This is very funny.
Save this sissy foot. Okay, and we'll render that out. And now we'll dive into here. Where was it? Okay, I don't know if I have a tracking point for the foot itself, but maybe if I just parent it to the head's null, it'll be similar. Okay, let's put the anchor point there. I always like to put the anchor point kind of near the, you know, whatever. Oh my God. Why? Oh, this perspective was not good at all. What was I thinking?
I've got to redo this
track. It's
got
to be way down here.
Oh man. I'm good to keep going for a little bit.
Oh geez. Here we go, everybody.
Oh my okay. Lord, it's so good.
We're getting there. We need oh geez. Okay, you can go back to yourself for a little bit.
Not yet. I gotta fix a track real quick.
Okay, I'm gonna see if there is anything I can do with this leg. Let's grab the leg here, copy it out of there, and we'll move it into this Tom bandages location. Oh, foot through the face. It's horrifying. Let's say save project as broken leg. This is very silly. This is all because I didn't want to buy a model of it was probably totally adequate. Grab all of these, let's rotate them around and sort of fit them here. I don't know. Let's see if their scale were a little bit. Like this. I don't know how many copies I'd have to do of this. Let's try this. Wrap. Why are they doing that? Why do they have this weird gravity toward the bottom of the foot? It just doesn't like this creepy leg. Maybe there's not enough points on it, and maybe it not being connected originally makes it very confused. What if I remesh it? Let's put it in a... Let's put the leg in a volume mesher. Whoops, I meant to say a volume builder and then a volume mesher. And can. Let's turn the voxel size down on that. And on the mesh here, we'll turn that up. So we're creating a new mesh here. Ooh, this looks like those 3D printed legs, like right at that stage right here, which are super cool. Turn up the adaptiveness a little bit, and we'll render that out as a little volume here. Now we'll add a collider tag to that. Does this wrap better? Play. A little bit better. Maybe there's not enough friction on these.
Friction.
Turn up the friction and the stick. And maybe that was the whole issue. Oh my gosh, look, it's perfect. Can't even see because of the color disparity. Oh gosh, that's a messed up leg. I just applied a male body texture to the whole thing, and so it's got like toes by the knee. Anyway, this is so disturbing. I'm sorry if you're just tuning in. But yeah, we're trying to simulate a cast here. So let's grab these three, might as well, and then we'll do the current state to object, and then we're going to take all of those objects that I just created. There's got to be a faster way to do this, and then delete these tags from them. So now they're just there. We'll go back to the first frame, and we'll have these again. We can move. I guess we want more of these, huh? I don't remember what you're working on, and if I'm.
I was trying to redo a
track. If I'm boring people with this part.
I was trying to redo a track here that's all weird and don't love it. I really, really want to finish this shot for the show today. So I'm going to try to export null and appearance to that null.
Shrink these ones down. There they go. They wrap nicely. They're a little bit too long, so I'm going to make the target length in the cloth a little bit shorter. Let's try 50%. Press play. It'll shrink down and mush themselves in. I kind of don't mind the wrinkles that much. I think if I play for a second, they might smooth themselves out a little bit. Oh, maybe the stickiness is contributing to that. So maybe the friction should be up on these objects, but the stickiness doesn't need to be so high. So let's turn down the stick, but let's leave friction up. Let's try that. Press play. There we go. That's a little bit smoother. On the cloth objects, I'm going to turn up the stretchiness a little bit and turn down the bendiness. So there's fewer folds, which I think is what's happening. I don't know. So this should be a smoother wrap, if I'm correct. Yeah, there we go. Smoother looking. Though they're all doing this weird little fold-up party streamer thing. Maybe they're too big. I guess asking the cloth to shrink that much is a lot. It was mostly so I didn't have to be very precise with where I'm doing this. I still think my helix thing, there's a way to have made that work. I messed it up.
I mean, you made it work before the show is the thing people don't realize and need to realize.
That's the hard thing. Yeah, whenever we pull something off right before the show and we're like, that's so cool, we're going to show everybody this new trick that we didn't know before. And then this happens.
Don't show them.
I know. Because Michael wasn't here with his knowledge.
What are you talking about? Oh, yeah.
Sending love and care to Michael and family.
Sending love and care, much like Ethan needs love and care. I don't know why, but this track is giving me the damnedest friggin' time, but this is all I could get to with this shot for now.
Hey, you know what? It's amazing.
It's something.
It is. It's something.
I guess we should give up. Go home?
We should give up. This mission, apparently,
yeah,
wasn't feasible.
Well, everyone...
I don't know if there's another way to say that, but...
This mission was indeed not feasible. Mission infeasible.
Ugh. Wait, Seth, is your face frozen? I'm not actually looking at our stream.
Sometimes it does that. Let me see. Oh, it is. I look so...
Resting Seth face.
And let's fix me before we go. hi real quick and hi real quick. I'm back. Okay, so...
Hey, welcome back.
What we learned today, I don't know. Some stuff. It was fun.
I don't know. We did learn some stuff. I guess... I don't know. This is interesting. This is really all we should have done the whole time. It's just...
That foot is huge, dude.
Basically putting stickers on this stuff. And then maybe we could add... I guess, if I were really getting into there, I would be like...
It needs to be hanging from the
6 by the handle. Like 2...
It needs a sling from the handle to the leg that's holding it up. Oh, that's
a good idea. Wait, 6 by, let's see, I don't know. How many degrees? 15 degrees? There we go. So now
it's rocking.
So this is so, not advised by the impossible doctor. Anyway, this was fun. Whether or not we got to anything, we did get through a lot of crazy tips, cloth wrapping and texture projection and geotracking and obscurations for necks. It's ridiculous.
It is pretty ridiculous.
All the knowledge. Well, take this knowledge and use it well, friends, and please do share anything that you ever create online with us, because we love looking at your work and we also love talking about it here on the show. So, tweet that stuff at us at Action Movie Kid and Awakeland 3D.
Do it. And, or Instagram at The Seth Worley and The Action Movie Kid. And most importantly, Michael, thank you. Oh, I forgot. Oh. All right, guys. We'll see you all next week.
This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds.
Oh, baby, let's VFX and chill. Our weekly talk show where Seth and Hoshi break down visual effects from movies and shows. Then try to put them back together again.